Let's pray and dive into the Word. Father, we thank you for this wonderful conference, for all the people that are working behind the scenes and those that we can see. But also we pray, Father, that your Word will never come back void, but it will go and achieve that which it was sent for. We thank you, we bless you, and we ask that you will now speak. We don't want to hear man's opinions, we want to hear your Word. We thank you and we bless you, and we ask you to sanctify us today by your Word. Your Word is truth. Sanctify us by this truth. In the name of the Word of God, Yeshua, we pray. Amen. So, good afternoon. Shabbat Shalom. See, over the last few weeks, I got to see Barry more than my wife. But I got some photos, so I'm updated. But I'm so glad to be here. Unfortunately, in my country, this is not a good day. It's a very, very bad day. The nation is mourning the loss of at least 7 people who were in a very cold-blooded manner, were massacred by a Palestinian terrorist last night outside of a synagogue. And even this morning, a 13-year-old brainwashed Palestinian boy opened fire at a group of Israeli worshipers right by the city of David in Jerusalem. And these were all the people that were either injured or killed were actually Jewish worshipers, either going to pray or coming back from a prayer. None of them was guilty of anything but of being a Jew in the land of Israel. And in light of some things that were actually said right here from the state of California and echoed all over the world recently, I thought it'll be good if my message and this conference will deal with 3 things. Each and one of them is a topic for probably days or weeks of teachings, but I will just try to touch them all together in a way that we can understand what is it in the last days that we need to hold on to. And I'm talking about Judaism, Zionism, and anti-Semitism. Well, a few months ago, a rap artist called Kanye West, you know him? Well, he tweeted this. He said, "I'm a bit sleepy tonight, but I wake up. When I wake up, I'm going DEFCON 3 on Jewish people." And then he said, "The funny thing is, I actually can be anti-Semitic because black people are actually Jew also. You guys have toyed with me and tried to blackball." Now, by the way, I don't come against him. What happened after is that people were standing on bridges in Los Angeles with big signs, "Hitler was right." And quoting Kanye West for what he said, and saluting the Nazi salute from the bridges above freeways in Los Angeles. Now, right after he said that, and again, you know, he has some issues that he needs to deal with some professionals. So it's not that he is the issue here. The issue is that we see the ugly face of anti-Semitism even when people say they're not. But then when you see, actually my problem was with all the reaction that came after that, everybody says, "I support my Jewish friends and the Jewish people." Now, what is my problem? Half of those who tweeted that were people who hate Israel. But they have no problem with the Jewish people. And this is why this message is here this afternoon. We're going to try and understand, what is the story of people with connecting Israel with the Jewish people? And you have to understand, anti-Semitism is not only the hatred towards the Jews, but it's a hatred towards Israel. Because this is the place that was promised to the Jews. This is the place where is the only place on planet Earth that is known as the Jewish place, the Jewish homeland for the Jewish people. Therefore, if you've got a problem with that place as the place of the Jews, you've got a problem with the Jews. Believe it or not. You actually oppose the return of the Jews to their ancestral homeland. So I wanted to identify with you, first of all, the Jewish people, and I wanted to get you back on a timeline to the times of the promised land to Abraham. Because you know what? Abraham was not a Jew, and Jesus was not a Christian. And people don't understand that. Jesus cannot be a follower of Christ. He is the Christ. The Bible says in Genesis 17, no longer God is telling Abraham, at that time called Abraham, no longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. That's a 99-year-old man that is receiving these news. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come out of you, and I will establish my covenant between you, between me and you, and your descendants after you in their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you. Also, I give to you and your descendants after you the land in which you are a stranger, all the land of Canaan, as a what? Everlasting possession, and I will be their God. So we see that the component of the land was one of the first things that God is communicating to Abraham when it comes to his covenant with him. In Leviticus 25, verse 23, the first part says, the land shall not be sold permanently, for the land is mine. God is saying that. It doesn't belong to people, it belongs to God, and it is God who gave it to the rightful descendants of Abraham. And it's important that you understand that he gave it to the descendants of Isaac, and it will later on give it to the descendants of Jacob. And this is where we have also the component of what we call the seed. In Genesis 17, God also said to Sarah, Sarah, your wife shall bear this a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his what? Seed after him. In Genesis 26, and the Lord appeared unto him and said, go not down into, this is of course to Abraham, don't go to Egypt, dwell in the land which I shall tell thee of, sojourn in this land, and I will be with thee and will bless thee, for unto thee and unto thy seed I will give all these countries, and I will perform the oath which I swear unto Abraham thy father. This is of course Isaac, and I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, and it will give unto thy seed. Look how many times he's talking about the seed, the seed, the seed, the seed. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. So when I speak about the seed, I'm of course referring to a specific lineage of people. And that's what's revealed in the Bible. The promise was made to Abraham, assured to his descendants, specifically Isaac, not Ishmael, and then Jacob and not Esau. That's what the Bible says. And now comes the blessing. There's the people, there's the land, the seed, and now comes the blessing. Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house, to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great what? Nation. Not religion. And then he said, I will what? bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth, not all the individuals, all the nations will be what? Blessed. The blessing is connected to the seed, that is connected to the land, that is connected to the promise that was given to Abraham. Do we understand that? The blessing could only come when the seed is in the land. In fact, every time God wanted to punish Israel, that's when they had to leave. And every time God wanted to restore Israel, this is when he brought them back to the land. Remember that. Now I want to tell you something. Even the Arabs knew that 100 years ago. I'm going to quote what the leader of the holiest sites to the Muslims, the Sharif of Mecca, Hussein, after him, King Hussein of Jordan was named. This is the grandfather of King Hussein of Jordan. Look what he wrote to his people over 100 years ago. He wrote in Al-Qibla, the daily newspaper of Mecca, in 1918. Look what he wrote. The resources of the country are still virgin soil and will be developed by the Jewish immigrants. One of the most amazing things until recent times was that the Palestinian used to leave his country, wandering over the high seas in every direction. His native soil could not retain a hold on him. At the same time, we have seen the Jews from foreign countries streaming to Palestine. Remember that in 1918, from Russia, Germany, Austria, Spain, and America. Now, if I stop here, you would say, ooh, look, he's saying that the Palestinians were here and the Jews are those who came from outside. Watch this. The same Hussein, the Sharif of Mecca, continued. It says, the cause of causes could not escape those who had a gift of deeper insight. They knew that the country was for its original sons. The Muslim is telling his own people that the land actually does not belong to them, but to the original sons, for all their differences, a sacred and beloved homeland. The return of these exiles to their homeland will prove materially and spiritually an experimental school for their brethren who are with them in the fields, factories, trade, and all things connected to the land. He basically said, we want those original sons to come back to their original homeland, because that is when, what is going to come? The blessing! I'm getting angry right now. You see, there was a peace treaty in 1919, signed already by the Arabs. But the Arabs added, and by the way, in that peace treaty, it says, the land belongs to the Jews. It says, but please help us develop our own countries all around you. It was signed by Weizmann, Chaim Weizmann, and it was signed by the son of Hussein. But then what he added is, pending on the British fulfillment of their promises to us. And the British did not fulfill their promises to the Arabs, and the Arabs said, okay, then there's no deal with the Jews. See, there was an exodus from Egypt in the time of Moses. After hundreds of years of Jewish exile, God, the Bible says, the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt. So the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. By the way, the first anti-Semitism we know of is with Pharaoh and his army. Why did they want to kill the Jewish people? Because they were different. because their God caused their king to let the people go. It's because God has a different plan for Israel, a destiny as a nation in the land that God gave them. It had nothing to do with religion. Israel didn't even know their God at that time. Remember, Moses had to ask God, remind me, what's your name? What am I going to tell them? They didn't know the name of their God. But God knew them. Because God is faithful to his what? Promise of the land, seed, and blessing. So it had nothing to do with religion. The return to the land has nothing to do with religious practices of any Jew. It has to do with the faithfulness of God. And it has to do with the promises of him to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. And when they came back into the land, Joshua said, after the death of Moses, the Bible says, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, and you and all these people to the land which I am giving to them. The children of Israel, if you want to understand who is them, the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses, from the wilderness and the Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites and the great sea towards the going of the sun shall be your territory. God promised, God is blessing. And it was Joshua that reminded the children of Israel that if they want to remain in the land, and if they want to enjoy the blessing, they have to obey God and walk in his ways. Therefore, fear the Lord, serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord, he said, and if it is seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, what? We will serve the Lord. It's a choice, even to the Jews. Do you think a single Jew will enter into the New Jerusalem just because he's a Jew? Absolutely not. Do you think a single Jew will even be in the millennial kingdom after the, you know, terrible tribulation? Do you think he will be allowed into the millennial kingdom just because he's a Jew? Absolutely not. Thankfully, when Jesus comes back, his eyes will see him and they will repent. And that repentance and that acceptance of Jesus is their ticket to the millennial kingdom, as well as later on to the New Jerusalem. A choice that was already given to them then. And then they were in the Babylonian captivity, and we know that in 2 Kings chapter 24. And he carried out from there all the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. And he cut in pieces all the articles of gold which Solomon, king of Israel, had made in the temple of the Lord, as the Lord had said. Also, he carried into captivity all Jerusalem, all the captains, all the mighty men of God, mighty men of valor, 10,000 captives, and all the craftsmen and smiths. None remained except the poorest people of the land. God carried out these people as a judgment upon them. And during that era, anyone who understood and believed the promises of God mourned because of Israel's exile from the land. Nehemiah mourned before the king, if you remember. And going back to the land was extremely important because it was part of keeping their identity as chosen people. You see, Nehemiah was in the palace. He could have stayed there. He could have said, you know what?
lunch, man. This is a great place. No, he chose to do this journey to be ridiculed by everybody along the way and to build the walls and the city and the temple. Because the connection between the people and the land brought the blessing. It brought their identity. It brought their destiny. It brought who they are. That's what God meant them to be to begin with. God never told Abraham, I'll make you a religion. He said to him, I will make you a great nation. And this is exactly why Satan is messing up with the minds of so many people. To love the Jews, but to hate the, you know, whenever they come back to the land, that's a crime. Think about it. It's exactly the opposite. And then Jesus arrives. Messiah arrives, the promised Messiah of Israel, the Savior of the world. He came to the people of Israel in the land of Israel to fulfill the feasts of Israel and to bring some association finally between Gentiles and Israel. It's him who is the light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of his people Israel. He was not in Salt Lake City or in the watchtower somewhere in New York City or in an island in the Philippines. He came to his own. The fact that they received him not then didn't mean that he rejected them. They rejected him. And guess where he's coming back to? Not to New York City, but to Mount of Olives. And guess who is going to look at him and repent? Galatians says, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman. Hello? Nowadays you have to make it clear. Born of a woman, born under the law. Jesus was born, if anything, I lead tours and, take people around. And one time a lady from the South, she asked me, so I'm confused, was Jesus Catholic or Orthodox? I said, I'll confuse you even more. He was a Jew. She wanted her money back, I think. He was born under the law. And then after Jesus was crucified, and after he resurrected, he had to have been crucified and resurrected, then the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. Why was it so important for him to come before and not after? Because Daniel's prophecy had to be fulfilled. And in Daniel's prophecy, the Messiah would come, be cut off for nothing that he did, and then the people of the great kingdom will come and destroy the temple and the city. And prophetically speaking, national Israel, even by Jesus himself, was promised some sort of death and coming back to life in the future when he spoke about the fig tree. And when he saw the fig tree on one day and then the following day, and eventually when he prophesied that the day will come and a generation will live to see the coming back to life of that fig tree. Learn this parable from the fig tree. When its branch has already become tender and puts forth leaves, you know that summer is near. So you also, when you see all these things, know that it is near. Jesus is speaking to you right now. You're the generation. We're the generation that we can see Israel back in the land. The fig tree is blooming again. We are the generation that should know that it is near at the doors. Assuredly, Jesus is saying to us, this generation will by no means pass away until all these things take place. Wow. And the Jewish people for 2,000 years were in diaspora, away from their land. And following their removal from the land under the Romans, they were mistreated all over the world. And as God said, they would be for nearly 2,000 years away. The Jewish people were considered subjects once they left Judea. That's why we're called Jews. They were subjects of the
kingdom of Judea. They are now left without independence, without a land. So they are the subject of the kingdom of Judea under the auspices of local kings wherever they are. They were always known as those from Judea, therefore Jews. And the Jewish people were considered a nation without a passport of a country that did not exist anymore. They actually were not considered part of the nations where they lived, but they were under their custody. And for so long, until the 1700s, Jews had no rights anywhere. Nothing. Because they are a nation without a country. And God forbid, they will take our country. In the attempt to be accepted by the nations, they received emancipation at the expense of their national identity. The emancipation did not begin until the late 1700s. Prior to that, Jewish people had to wear special clothing to distinguish themselves. They were forbidden from voting. Some countries wouldn't even permit them to enter their own land, such as Norway and Sweden and Spain, after the expulsion in the late 15th century. The first group of Jewish settlers in America, by the way, arrived in 1654. However, it wasn't until 1790 that George Washington established that Jews in America share all the same equal rights when it comes to practicing their religion. Could you imagine? They arrived in 1654, only in 1790. They were, okay, you are equal. Nevertheless, Jews were still prohibited, by the way, from serving in different offices in America until the 1900s. It was under former President Franklin Roosevelt that Jews found a political home in America. Now, I'm not, he was very smart in the way he did things. Very smart. He realized that if you give them a political homeland, you got them forever. They'll vote for you forever. This is it. Up until today, the Jews are slaves to the Democrat Party. Can't you see that? This is how they secure the vote of the Jewish people for years to come. The Third Reich between 1933 and 1945, Jews were outside their land, and nations could see that there was no blessing. The seed was up for extermination during the Third Reich. I'm not talking about before or after. I'm talking about Third Reich. The whole world was watching how the nation that God chose is up for extermination. People were asking, where is this whole God component here? Not to mention the beginning of the Holocaust in 1941 all the way to 1945. In a beautiful villa on the shores of a lake in the suburbs of Berlin called Wannsee, a group of officials, Nazi officials, over dessert, decided on the final solution to the Jewish problem. The Jews, in their eyes, of the Nazis and their collaborators, were a problem. And it was easy to deal with them when they were in a vulnerable state being out of their land. That's why we have the IDF today. You know what the IDF stands for? It's Israel's Defense Forces. You're not going to do that to us anymore. And then there is the modern state of Israel, the independence in 1948. And from God's perspective, Israel not being in the land that he gave them was a profanity, actually. If you really think about it, look at what Ezekiel heard from God. When they came to the nations, wherever they went, they profaned my holy name. When they said of them, what was the profanity? When the nation said of them, these are the people of the Lord. And yet they have gone out of his land. But I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the nations. By disobeying me and causing me to judge you and take you out of your land, and you being away, everybody thinks that, wait a minute, aren't these God's people? And God says, thus says the Lord, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. And I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations. And then he says, and the nations, say that with me, the nations. God is wondering, God is interested in what the nations will see, will say, will believe. The nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the nations, gather you out of all countries, and bring you into your own land. This promise is not about the greatness of Israel. It's not about the perfect relationship of Israel with God. It's about God's name. And it's about God's reputation. And all pastors that are teaching replacement theology because, look, how can God still have a covenant with Israel when they're in disobedience? Well, read that. Isaiah 43, fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your descendants from the east and gather you from the west. And I will say to the north, give them up. And to the south, do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, I have formed him. Yes, I have made him. That's a promise. And up until today, as I am speaking to you, Jews, look, people ask me, what is the prophetic significance of the war in Ukraine? I said, look, there was nowhere in the Bible where the war in Ukraine is mentioned. But in the Bible, there's no war between other countries. It's always the relations of other countries and Israel. And what do we see in the last year? Record number of Jews returning back to their land from Russia and the Ukraine. Isaiah 66, who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall the earth be made to give birth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. Israel was born within a day. I don't know if you know that. The British declared that they're leaving. Nobody believed them. And they left. And we didn't know what to do. So we declared statehood. And we're a state since then. Overnight. We didn't have time to write the Declaration of Independence on one piece of paper. We wrote them in different pieces, then we sewed it together. Look, it's beyond a miracle. Because the day we said that, the day we declared statehood, we were attacked by five armies. When the judgment of God targeted Israel, it was always either drought or expulsion from the land. And when God was restoring the nation, it always involved bringing the people back. The land is an integral part of the life of the nation under God. So why do we still have Jewish people residing anywhere but the land of Israel? Look, there's only in the last few years, Israel surpassed the number of Jews in it over the number of Jews elsewhere. It's quite interesting. So what is Judaism? It's both biological and theological. I mean, you're born a Jew. You know, I did a DNA test. You can trace a Jew by a DNA test. It's a seed, remember. But then it's also, in the eyes of rabbis, it's also a theological thing. According to Britannica, it's a monotheistic religion developed among the ancient Hebrews. Judaism is characterized by a belief in one transcendent God who revealed himself to Abraham, Moses, and the Hebrew prophets, and by a religious life in accordance with scriptures and rabbinic traditions. Judaism is the complex phenomenon of a total way of life for the Jewish people, comprising theology, law, and innumerable cultural traditions. And by the way, most of today's Jewish religion is not based on the written word of God. In fact, the average born-again Christian knows more about the Old Testament than the average Orthodox Jew. They believe that on Mount Sinai, Moses was given also the oral law. And he passed it on from generation to generation until it had to be written down. And that is the Mishnah and then the Talmud and all of that. It's basically things that they believe Moses received from God on Mount Sinai, but it's not anything written from that time. In fact, look at this chart of how Judaism evolved. In the biblical era of the Old Testament, we have the biblical Judaism, which is basically people who were obviously chosen by God for a reason, and they mostly were around the prophets of Israel, the kings and the prophets, all the way to the 4th century before Christ. And then, of course, we have the Hellenistic Judaism. When Israel was conquered by Greece, by Alexander the Great, we were exposed to a new world we had never seen before, a new set of lifestyles and gods and theologies. And Judaism adjusted itself to the new reality. So much so that when you go to Capernaum today and you see a synagogue from the, you know, 4th century BC, or AD, excuse me, you see that the synagogue was built the other way around. The door is not facing Jerusalem, it's facing the north. And you're asking, why did they build that this way? Didn't they know where Jerusalem is? Well, they knew. But they didn't want the door to be open from the other side because the gods of the Gentiles are dwelling on the mountains. God forbid they will enter into the synagogue. You see, they started adjusting themselves to the fact that there's other cultures that you have to get along with. But even then, there was an expectation for the Messiah, for those who really, truly believed in the written word of God. And this is exactly what old Simeon was doing in the temple, praying and looking for the consolation of Israel, the Bible said. They expected him to come. Few. The majority expected someone else. They're now exposed to great Alexander the Great and all the other rulers. They want a ruler also. They want independence, but they want a ruler, a king. They get someone who is riding a donkey. They get someone who is poor. They get someone who is not married. He has no kids. He gets someone who is actually hanged on a tree like the worst criminal, according to the book of Leviticus. Only those criminals were hanged on a tree. So, from the moment Jesus was crucified on, rabbinical Judaism began to develop itself as a way to negate Messianic Judaism, to oppose it, to offer only true rabbinical views. And they changed it, by the way, that the Jew is now after the mother, not after the father. It was always after the father. It was always the seed. But then, of course, now it's after the mother. And of course, modern Judaism from 1750 all the way to today, now Jews were exposed to agendas of liberalism, of secularism, of all of the philosophers and others, and they twisted their mind all the way. Ladies and gentlemen, Isaiah said, when you come to appear before me, speaking of the religion that the Jews had created, Who has required this from your hand? To trample my courts, bring no more futile sacrifices, incense is an abomination to me, the new moons, the Sabbaths, and the calling of assemblies. I cannot endure iniquity and the sacred meetings, your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. I can't believe I'm reading that. God says to the Jewish people, what you have created from my word is something that I cannot even recognize. I hate it. They are trouble to me. I'm weary of bearing them. And when you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Therefore, the Lord said in Isaiah 29, inasmuch as these people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts from me, far from me, and their fear towards me is taught by the commandments of men. Rabbinicals. Now, what is Zionism? Zionism is somewhat a recent term. By the way, it was coined in 1890. But it's actually something that is based on the word Zion, which appears 176 times in the Bible. So it's definitely biblical. The word Zion occurs not only that many times, but it means fortification, to be raised up, a monument. And later on, we see progression of it all the way until it started describing the people of Israel. And I'm going to move on all the way through Isaiah and also through Psalm 132 and through Psalm 2, all the way talking about Zion until even you see in 1 Peter chapter 2, therefore it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And you can clearly see that the word Zion is beyond just a geographical thing. Now, Isaiah said, put on your strength, O Zion, put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city, for the uncircumcised and the unclean shall no longer come to you. Now, interestingly enough, Zionism is the belief in the God-given right of the Jewish people to the land of Israel. You understand that? Zionism is the belief of the God-given right to the Jewish people over the land of Israel and their duty to return to it, because Zionism was coined outside of the land of Israel. Again, it's both theological and national. We emphasize the theological side of Zionism because there are no national rights without recognizing our God-given rights first. God is the one who gave us the land. He's the one who wanted us to return to the land, and he's the one who brought us back to the land. My grandparents did not want to go back to Israel, but then came the Holocaust, and then, of course, they were the first ones surviving to board the boat in the shores of Italy, come all the way to Israel, and then the British police turned their boat, sent them to a detention camp in Cyprus, and this is where my mom was born. The Bible says in Ezekiel 37, the Lord said to me, son of man, these bones, description of the Holocaust, are the whole house of Israel. They indeed say our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves, and I will bring you into the land of Israel. That's the name of the land. And then you shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, says the Lord. God says, not only that I'm going to take you out, but I will place you in your land, the land of Israel, and it's no one else that can take the credit for it. I spoke it and I performed it. In the United Nations, or UN stands also for unnecessary or for United Nothing, in their General Assembly, in 1975, they adopted a resolution 3379, which says, it determined that Zionism is a form of racism and racial discrimination. Because how dare you say that you have a God-given right over the land? And this is, by the way, at the time, the ambassador of Israel to the United Nations, which is the father, he became the president of Israel, and he's the father of the present president of Israel. The determination that Zionism is a form of racism and racial discrimination contained in the resolution, it was eventually revoked in 1991 with a UN General Assembly resolution 4686. The Jews were out of their own land for so long that they became comfortable with their circumstances. When Zionism surfaced, it was a new thing to the Jews of that time and even to the rest of the world. The world was already used to a land with no life and no Jews. It rebirthed the idea of the divine calling upon the Jews to return to the land of Israel. And this is why in Psalm 126, it says, when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. We can't believe it. After 2,000 years, we're back. God is the one who brings us. The Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, not anyone else. Biblically, God saw the Jews as captives wherever they were out of their land. Isn't that interesting? Furthermore, he judged nations for their mistreatment of Israel outside of the land. And Jeremiah spoke about that captivity. He says, these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years, speaking of the judgment of the nations that did evil in the eyes of God against Israel. The judgment, I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, the land of the Chaldeans, for their iniquity, says the Lord, and I will make it a perpetual desolation. God is bringing back the Jews to the land. We can see that. The prophetic and spiritual significance of their return is phenomenal. Bible prophecy, as I said, is about the nations in Israel, and we can clearly see that. In Deuteronomy 32, it says, when the Most High divided their inheritance to the nations, then he separated the sons of Adam. He set their boundaries of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the place of his inheritance. Wow. The key to all prophecy is the Jew. You have to understand that. If the Jewish people would have not forsaken God and neglected the Sabbaths, there would have been no times of the Gentiles. The times of the Gentiles began when God transferred earthly rule from the kings of Israel to the Gentile king Nebuchadnezzar. And then it will continue until Israel again becomes the head of all nations. And that will be when Jesus will rule from Jerusalem during the millennial kingdom. And until then, God is bringing them back by air, by foot, by sea. Look at those photos from then and from now. Look at this 747 loaded with 1,000 Ethiopian Jews. And when they landed, it was 1,001 because the baby was born. Look at the annual Aliyah, the immigration to Israel. 2010, 19,000. 2011, 19,000. 2012. But these are people that come and automatically receive citizenship because they're Jewish people, because that's the only land for the Jewish people. Automatically. 18,000, 19,000, 26,000, 31,000, 27, 29, 30, 34. And by the way, more than 20,000 came from 70 countries in 2020, the year of COVID. More and more coming from all around the world. Look at all these newspapers reporting that. Christian author Doug Hershey wrote, in 2014 marked the first year in over 2,000 years that the nation with the largest Jewish population was Israel. With the borders of the land that was... Look, he says, ask yourself, which is greater? That after 460 years, God would bring them, would bring 2 million people back to his land out of one nation? Or that after 2,000 years, God would bring 6 million people from every nation to his land, we're definitely experiencing the time of the greater Exodus. Now, why should it matter to Christians if Jews are returning to Israel? For those of us who love the Lord, we're also watching ancient Bible prophecies being fulfilled before our very eyes. And the most repeated promise in the Old Testament is that God will return his people to the land. And Zionism is the attempt to reestablish the Jews in their land with their religious identity. You don't need to be a Jew to believe in Zionism, by the way. You can be a Gentile and still believe in the rights of the Jews over the land. Are you a Zionist? Because the world will portray you as racist if you call yourself Zionist. In today's progressive world, Judaism without Zionism neutralizes anti-Semitism. The two together are a major driving force for anti-Semitism. And anti-Semitism, according to Yad Vashem, is hatred of Jews as a people or of the Jew as a concept. According to Yad Vashem, the term anti-Semitism was first coined in the late 1870s. Subsequently, it is used with reference to all types of Jew hatred, both historical and contemporary. The word itself comes from the idea that Hebrew belongs to the Semitic language family, and thus Jews must be Semites. Many other languages also belong to the Semitic language family, such as Arabic or Aramaic or Amharic even of the Ethiopians. And therefore, other cultures could also be called Semites. However, there is no such thing as Semitism, and no other groups have ever been included in the hatred and prejudice denoted by anti-Semitism. Geographically, by the way, Shem's descendants settled in the region of Israel, but extending all the way down through the Arabian Peninsula. But anti-Semitism started when the Jews began to fulfill their destiny, which God promised through Abraham, to be a chosen and separated nation. And whether Israel is out of the land or back in the land, the Jews face opposition to their very existence. They were killed last night because they are Jews and because they're in the land. And during the Exodus, even though the Israelites did not fully understand their calling and destiny, God made it clear to them and their enemies. Numbers 23, if you remember what Balaam said, he took up his oracle and said, Balak, the king of Moab, has brought me from Aram, from the mountains of the east. Come, curse Jacob for me, and come, denounce Israel. How shall I curse whom God has not cursed? And how shall I denounce whom the Lord has not denounced? For from the top of the rocks I see him, and from the hills I behold him. There, a people dwelling alone, not reckoning among the nations. The sad part is that even though God manifested himself to the Gentiles through the Jewish people via his son and his word, wherein he warned them about thinking that he had forgotten about Israel, he warned them about that. Anti-Semitism mostly flourished. Look at this, among Christians. If I go to Asia, where there was no Christianity, if I go to any place that Christianity did not exist, there's no anti-Semitism. Did you know that? It's amazing. The people who were warned by the Apostle Paul, by God himself, not to think that God is done with Israel, are those who instigated most of the anti-Semitism. Christians have had a problem with the exception of the status of the Jewish people. Muslims mostly have had a problem with the establishment of the state of Israel. But before the Jewish people returned to Israel, before 1948, Muslims actually did not see the Jews as enemies. Did you understand that? Israel's existence in general and their miraculous return to their ancestral homeland in particular is a major blow to replacement theology. Romans 11 says, you will say then, branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Well said, because of unbelief they were broken off, and you stand by faith. Do not be haughty, but fear. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he may not spare you either. Therefore, consider the goodness and the severity of God on those who felt severity, but towards you goodness. But if you continue in his goodness, otherwise, you also will be cut off. And they also, if they do not continue in unbelief, will be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. For if you were cut off of the olive tree, which was wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these who are natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree? He's not canceling them. He's saying, once they repent, boom, I will accept. It's actually so natural for me to accept them. I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until there's an expiration date. It's the only nation on planet Earth that has an expiration date for their blindness. And it says, until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And then what? Say that. All Israel shall be saved. It is written, the deliverer will come out of Zion, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. And Paul continued, and he said to the Christians who lived in Rome. He never met them, by the way, when he wrote it. He's never been to Rome yet. He said, concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. Of course, they turn you in. They turn me in. They want me dead. But look what he says. But concerning the election, they are beloved for the sake of what? The fathers. Let's go back. Promise, land, seed, blessing. He goes back to the promise. For the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet have now obtained mercy through their disobedience, even so these also have now been disobedient, that through the mercy shown you, they also may obtain mercy. For God has committed them all to disobedience, that he might have mercy on all. Israel's return to the land is a major threat also, not just to Christian insecurity, but also to Islamic superiority and ownership over the region. See, this is when the Muslims started having problem with us, when we returned to the land. That's why in Psalm 83, which I believe was fulfilled in 1948, do not keep silent, do not be still, God. Behold, your enemies make tumult, and those who hate you lifted up their heads, for they have taken crafted counsel against your people, consulted again against your sheltered ones. And they said, come, let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel will be remembered no more. The minute we change the name from Palestine to Israel, boom, let's destroy them. So the name of Israel will be remembered no more. And even when Israel will face near annihilation, God will fight for them. Ezekiel 38, it will come to pass at the same time when Gog comes against the land of Israel, says the Lord God, that my fury will show in my face, for in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath I have spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great earthquake in the land of Israel, so that the fish of the sea and the birds of heavens, the beasts of the fields and all creeping things that creep in the earth, and all men who are on the face of the earth shall shake at my presence. The mountains shall be thrown down, the steep places shall fall, and every And in every wall shall fall in the ground, he says. I will call for a sword against Gog throughout all my mountains, says the Lord God. Every man's sword will be against his brother, and I will bring him to judgment with pestilence and bloodshed, he said. And I will rain down on him, on the troops, and on many people who are with them, flooding rain, great hailstone, fire and brimstone, and thus I will magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. Near annihilation, and God intervenes, says, you can keep your army to yourself. I have other way to destroy your enemies. Jeremiah 31 says the same thing. Only when the sun and the moon and the stars will no longer be there, then Israel will cease from being a nation before God. So in light of everything we've covered, if you call yourself a Christian, yet you hate the Jewish people, you may believe in a different Bible. Even Paul, towards the end of his life, having been persecuted and ridiculed by the religious Jews, had the following things to say. It came to pass after 3 days that Paul called the leaders of the Jews together. And so when he had come together, he said to them, men and brethren, though I have done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans, who when they examined me wanted to let me go because there was no cause for putting me to death. But when, by the way, whenever Paul said the Jews, he means the leadership. When the Jews spoke, because he's speaking to Jews now, spoke against it, I was compelled to appeal to Caesar. Now, read it with me. Not that I had anything of which to accuse my nation. For this reason, therefore, I have called for you to see you and speak with you, because for the hope of Israel, I am bound with this chain. Jesus is not only the hope of the world, he is the only hope of Israel. When the hope of Israel will return to Israel, then the people of Israel will be in Israel to fulfill their destiny to once again be a light unto the nation. And thus Isaiah 2 verse 3, many people shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. So let us remember, don't ever separate the promise from the land, from the seed, from the blessing. And if you want to understand it all, keep them together. The minute you start picking and choosing which one you like and which one you don't, you disobey God, you don't understand his word, and you blaspheme his name. And this is why the enemy will always seek to destroy Israel and delegitimize it. And this is why every Christian should stand for the right of Israel to be back in their land. And if you tell me that there are Christians who call themselves Christians who hate Israel as God's land for his people, they need to read their Bible again. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your promises. We thank you that in the midst of so much grief and sorrow in Israel today, and so much confusion and deception that comes from Hollywood and from the entertainment establishment, we know your word is true. And we know that the only hope for Israel is Yeshua, Jesus. And we also know that you promised, and he who promised is faithful. You gave them the land, you gave the seed, and you gave the blessing. And to you be the glory and the honor today. And all of God's people say, amen.